Here we go. My 2024 started with this amazing view. A sea lion wanted to kiss me. A couple of hammerhead sharks invited me for dinner. But I decided to skip it. You know, just in case. I prefer to party with dolphins instead. But this white-tipped shark did not like the noise from the party, so we had to stop. Then I ran a marathon with the Galapagos tortoise. And she won. No, I did not start my 2024 in an aquarium or a zoo. I am talking about one of the Galapagos Islands, San Cristobal. The Galapagos Islands are one of the most unique places on Earth. If you don't believe me, ask Charles Darwin. Well, you've probably heard that these islands inspired Darwin to create his theory of evolution. As for me, the Galapagos Islands inspired me to make this video for you to help you plan a trip to this place. First of all, why did I choose January to visit this place? In the Galapagos, the time between December and mid-May is considered the wet season. These are warmer months, and ocean is relatively calm with more clear and warmer water, which is great for snorkeling. The second reason why I choose the beginning of January is because before arriving in the Galapagos Islands, I wanted to see how people celebrate New Year on the mainland of Ecuador, as I've heard it's very unusual. But I'll make a separate video about it. Why did I choose San Cristobal Island? Of course, it's better to visit several islands if you have time. Unfortunately, I had only 6 days, including arrival and departure days, left for the Galapagos. If you have to choose one of the islands, then San Cristobal is a good choice, and here's why. First of all, San Cristobal Island is known to have most of the species common for the Galapagos, except for the penguins. If you want to see penguins, you should go to Isabella and Fernandina Islands. Also, San Cristobal has one of the best snorkeling places for the beginners – Kicker Rock. I'll tell you more about it later. And last but not least, San Cristobal is accessible by plane. I'll make another video to talk about the details you need to know before going to the Galapagos Islands. For now, let me describe my 5-day itinerary here at San Cristobal Island and show you all its beauty as much as I can. Day 1. Arrival. So on January 1st, 2024, at 1 p.m, our plane from Quito, the capital of Ecuador, touched the land of San Cristobal Island. I did not expect much from this day after the New Year celebration in Quito, and honestly I was quite tired. However, I did expect to get out of the airport fast, as it was a flight inside the country. But instead, we spent about 40 damn minutes standing in line to pay the Galapagos National Park entry fee. The thing is that the entire Galapagos archipelago is a national park, and you have to pay a 100 fee per adult and 50 bucks per kid between 2 and 12 years old upon arrival. Here I need to mention that this amount is planned to be doubled starting August 2024. There is no way to pay the fee online, and they don't accept credit cards. Is it really 2024? Come on! So prepare cash. Oh, and I forgot to tell you that you also have to pay 20 bucks per person for a Galapagos Transit Control card before arrival to the Galapagos Islands. Of course, this has to be done in cash at the airport of departure, and of course, you need to stay in line for another 20-30 minutes. Why can't these payments be combined? Don't ask me. I don't know. Downtown is very close to the airport. You can even have a 10-15 minutes walk there if you don't have many bags with you or kids. We stayed at Hotel Isla Galapagos, which is 3 minutes away from the airport by taxi. The hotel was pretty basic. The water in the shower was a bit cool, but it was okay. We were not there for a luxury experience. We were there for wildlife and breathtaking nature views. Speaking about wildlife, sea lions are probably going to be the first cute creatures you'll see once you arrive, because San Cristobal's colony of sea lions is the largest in the Galapagos Islands. They are literally everywhere. Look at this guy. He's coming back from work, right? Iguanas are also very comfortable to be among the people. Well, at least it looks like that. I think they just know who these islands really belong to. My main goal for the arrival day was to book excursions for our stay on the island. Every travel blogger who visited the Galapagos Islands recommended booking excursions once you arrive on the islands instead of online, as it's much cheaper. But, surprise, it appeared that we did not bring enough cash, and first of all, it was hard to find an agency that would accept credit cards, and second, once we finally found one, they charged a 7% fee for the credit transaction. One more reminder to bring a lot of cash with you. So, to give you an idea of how much you'd save if you book an excursion on the island versus online, let's compare the prices. The online price for one of the most popular excursions on the island, called Tour 360, varies from 190 to 245 per person, based on my search on Google. We paid for the 360 tour $162 per person, including a 7% transaction fee. With cash, it would cost us $151 per person. Anyway, the mission for the first day was complete, and I was so excited for the next day. Day 2, 360 tour. On day 2, we had an early start. The adventure started at 7:45 am. Sea lions were already refreshed and ready for the day, but I was not. I am definitely not an early bird. The 360 tour takes you around the island with two stops for snorkeling. The first one is the famous Kicker Rock. It is also called Sleeping Lion. And it is a stunning volcanic rock formation with incredible marine life. And the second snorkeling spot is Bahia Rosa Blanca. They provide you with snorkeling gear, wetsuits, and lunch. While approaching Kicker Rock, we saw many dolphins. Our tour guide stopped the boat and let us jump in the water to swim with these beautiful creatures. The tour guide explained that this is something that does not happen on every excursion, so I guess we were just lucky. Then we approached Kicker Rock. The boat stopped close to the channel between the two big formations. We were supposed to swim in between these two formations, and the boat goes around the rocks and meets you on the other side of the rocks. Pretty wild, right? Well, there is a current that helps you swim through the channel, so it was quite easy. The water here is cool, and a wetsuit is needed. Kicker Rock is a place where it is possible to see hammerhead sharks, and I really hope to see one. But unfortunately, I was not lucky this time. A few guys from our group saw them, but not me. The hammerheads were quite deep. Damn. Well, it was still a great experience. The next stop should have been a beach where we could relax, but the conditions there were quite rough and we had to pass it. They promised to give us more time at the next snorkeling place instead. At Bahia Rosa Blanca, we were met by sharks. But our tour guide told us that they were vegetarians, and we believed him and went swimming with them. Then we had a lunch and did a wet landing. And then we had to walk about 10-15 minutes to a lagoon for snorkeling. You should wear water shoes or something like that, because it's a lava rock road, so don't go barefoot. You don't need a wetsuit to snorkel at this lagoon. The water here is not as cold as it is at Kicker Rock. At this place, you'll see how white-tip sharks take a rest. Big sea turtles. Stingrays. And many red crabs. By the way, these crabs can live up to 12 years in nature. Then they give you some time to relax on the beach. I must say that it was very hot in the middle of the day. And because the Galapagos is located close to the equator, you'll get burned very quickly. So don't forget to reapply sunscreen. During the tour, they also try to catch tuna, and you can take pictures with the catch. Also, there was one place where they did bird watching from the boat, and you can try to spot blue-footed, red-footed, and Nesca boobies. We were very tired at the end of the day, but full of emotions and memories. Day 3. Meeting Galapagos tortoises and swimming with sea lions. Day 3 was more relaxing. We did not have to wake up early, but we did plan another excursion for that day. We wanted to see the huge Galapagos tortoises. The first stop on our way to the tortoises was El Yunque Lagoon. This is a volcanic crater lake fed by rainfall. You need to hike to the top for about 10-15 minutes. The weather was rough, and the stairs to the lagoon were dirty and slippery. I was not impressed with the view at the top. They say this place is featuring a variety of wildlife, like frigate birds. But maybe because of the foggy weather, we did not see any. Then we arrived at the tortoises' breeding center. The purpose of the center is to increase the population of giant tortoises. They are bred in conditions similar to their natural environment. By walking on the center's trail, you can see tortoises in different stages of growth, from newborns to 120 days old. At this point, they are taken back to their habitat, where they will be able to survive on their own. Fun fact: Galapagos tortoises can live up to 177 years. The last stop of the excursion was Puerto China Beach. It's about a 10-minute walk from the parking lot. You can also see sea lions there. Retrospectively, I think it might make sense to take a taxi and visit just tortoises breeding center. It should be much cheaper and faster. To me personally, El Yunque Lagoon and Puerto China Beach did not bring much value, but it's just my personal opinion. In the afternoon, we decided to visit La Lobería Beach. To get there, we called a taxi from our hotel, and it was like 5 minutes drive. La Lobería Beach is famous for its crystal clear water, with lava rocks and sea lion colonies. There are so many sea lions in the water that you can swim with them. Some of them seemed so playful and welcoming you. You still should remember to keep distance, as sometimes they might get angry at you if you get too close. Besides swimming with sea lions, I saw stingrays, sea turtles, and lots of different types of fish. Really great snorkeling experience here. But the most exciting was to get closer to sea lions in the water. They're so fast there and so cute. The population of Galapagos sea lions has declined by 50% in the last 40 years. We saw how one baby sea lion died and got buried right at the beach. I've learned that it's important not to touch baby sea lions because sea lion moms recognize their babies by smelling them. When you touch one, it can interrupt their natural smell, and the baby can be rejected by their mom, and she might stop feeding them. Day 4. Punta Carola Beach. I'm not gonna lie and say that visiting Punta Carola Beach is a must in San Cristobal. However, if you have an extra day here, this wild beach won't disappoint you. If you are a surfer, this should be your place too. You need to do a bit of a hike to get here. But trust me, it's worth it. I enjoyed snorkeling here and saw this beautiful fish. Sea turtles, iguanas, and of course, sea lions. By the way, the water is not warm in Galapagos. Cold and warm currents mix together here, and you can feel it when you swim. It could get freezing cold sometimes. Just keep moving and you'll get into a warm current. Fun fact, the cold currents allow penguins to survive on the Galapagos Islands, despite the tropical latitude. Too bad that penguins don't live in San Cristobal, but it's one of the points for me to get back to Galapagos one day. Day 5. 360 tour. Yep, again. I could not let hammerhead sharks go. I just could not believe that I made all this way to these wild islands in the middle of nowhere and did not see the hammerheads. I had to get back to Kicker Rock to see them. Tour agencies here provide separate tours to Kicker Rock when you have more time for snorkeling than you have as a part of 360 tour. But there was no availability for Kicker Rock tour. So I signed up for another 360 tour. And believe it or not, I've seen the hammerhead sharks this time. I saw them right after I jumped out of the boat. You might wonder if hammerhead sharks are dangerous for people. According to the International Shark Attack File, there have been 16 incidents between humans and hammerhead sharks since 1900s. And of those, there have been 0 deaths. And none of them happened on the Galapagos Islands. I survived too. I also saw a sea lion this time at Kicker Rock. It was very close, like he was literally posing for my video. Maybe he heard about my YouTube channel. Who knows? Also, what was different from the first 360 tour is that the captain treated us with sashimi from just caught tuna and fed sharks. It was quite a show. I've never tried more delicious tuna sashimi before. I definitely do not regret that we took a second 360 tour. Our last sunset on San Cristobal did not disappoint either, as well as the view of sea lions getting ready for sleep. We left this island early afternoon on day 6. It's been half a year since then, but I still see dreams about sea lions cuddling in the water in front of me, iguanas walking between people, gigantic tortoises, and hammerhead sharks.